At some point, you have to ask yourself, how many knights armament rails is enough? Let me reset the camera here, and we're going to talk about my experience with the URX rails because I've installed a few of them. My favorite URX rail is the URX 3.1, and there's a reason for that. There's actually a few reasons for it. I actually have four of them if you include my 308 SR25 version of the 3.1. So, and this is a real, this middle gun here is a real Knights Armament SR16. So we're going to reset the camera. We're going to talk about the URX2. Then we'll talk about my Knights Armament rifle and why I have decided to install two more versions of that rail on different rifles. Here is my SR15. This is a Mod 1, I believe. SR15 E2 Mod 1. This is a very early version of the 3.1 rail, right when they moved from the 2 to the 3.1. I believe this guy was produced around 2012. I made some changes to it. It originally came with a SOPMod stock, an LMT SOPMod stock, and I switched this out for the Magpul Slim. And I put the SOPMod stock on my Mark 18 clone. This one has the QD on the back of the receiver. It came with the 200 to 600 rear backup sight, but I prefer the bigger aperture of this micro sight. See, that gigantic aperture makes the iron sights a lot faster. So that's what I really wanted to go with. So I actually traded that for some parts. And also, finally, it came with the 5.56 MAMS brake for the 5.56 QD, the new version of it, not the NT4. So it came with a $300 muzzle brake, and I traded that for a tack stamp for my AEM5 silencer. Also, I bought this guy used. Somebody put a piece of skateboard tape on it. And then it has just a mil-spec trigger. It's not anything special. I bought this guy in 2018 for $1,800. It's a pretty good deal at the time. Other than the couple things that I mentioned, the stock and the rear sight and the muzzle brake, it's factory. It came with this MIAD grip. And that's it. We'll turn it over here. We'll get a look at this side of the rifle. I believe it was made around 2012, 2011, right when they transitioned from the URX2. If you don't know, the URX3 is effectively the same as the URX2 rail. It just has scallop cuts to make it lighter. The 3.1, should I say. And it does not have an integrated front sight. The URX3 has a flip-up front sight into the rail. So it's the same as the two, except it just has the scallops. They just lightened it. I think this is the perfect rail, honestly. It's probably one of the most solid rails, and I love the profile of it. I think it looks great. There's a couple reasons why I have a couple of them here. Let me get the two on the table, and we'll talk about the comparison with the URX2. So here is an 11.5 inch BCM pistol that I basically made a CQB clone. But the URX2 rail, they mount the same way. They actually screw onto the upper receiver, and then a barrel nut actually screws into it and like compresses them together like that. But the URX2 has an integrated front sight. So when they went to the 3, all they did was take this rail and scallop it. And URX3 rails are very rare. And I think one of the reasons they stopped doing the integrated front sight is it was just too expensive to machine. I mean, it adds 100 to 150 bucks to the machine time for the rail. But these are super rock solid rails. URX2 is very heavy. I also think it looks very good. And I picked this guy up for a good deal. We'll show you this. Here, I'm trying to work around the camera. Let's see here. Notice this is a URX2. And then the URX3 has its own part number. I actually have this one up here with this part number. URX 3.1, that is the later version of it. This one is actually an AAC branded version of it, and I'll tell you why here in a second. So I did mount this one, and I did mount this one. This one came factory on the rifle. I didn't touch it. But what's interesting is, like, when I screwed this one on, there was a gap. I'll see if I can find a picture of the gap. But I actually fitted this rail to make sure that there's no gap. Sometimes if you look at these, you can see a gap between them because the thread face on the upper, it's basically, like, if it doesn't time correctly, you have to unscrew it all the way and mount it, and you get that one thread space. Bugs me. It really fit perfectly on this Remington Defense. I did not have to fit this one. And when I say fit, it means that I basically sanded down the back of that until I could screw it on one full rotation up. Like, if the rail stopped here, I wanted to get that rotation up. Let me show you what I mean by gap with the number 4. If you look here at the URX4, this one also kind of times onto the receiver. And you'll notice here at the top, there's a gap because that's how I had to time this receiver to fit. And it bugs me. And if you look at some of the Knights Armament rifles, some of them will have a gap and some of them won't. And it really, really bothers me. Which, with this integrated barrel nut of the URX4, you can't do anything about that. You're just kind of stuck with the way that thing times on there. But since the URX3s mount to the face of the upper receiver, you can fit them there. It takes a little bit of work. I had to do this one also. That's also a BCM upper. We're going to talk about that here. So let me clean everything off. We're going to give a short talk about my actual Knights Armament gun, and then we'll talk about the rails. When we talk about something like a Knights Armament are some of the best rifles you can get. They're tough, and they'll go 20, 30,000 rounds, no problems. But what's interesting is this Mod 1 here, this out-of-production Knights Armament rifle, is no longer made. And, you know, when I bought it, I paid $1,800 for it. And today, in 2020, 2021, at the end of 2021... they sell for $4,000 for the complete rifle. So you've moved from a collector's piece, or from a very functional fighting rifle, to a collector's piece. So, like, you know, I want to take this to classes and run it through classes. That's fine and all, but these have proprietary parts on them. The gas tube is different. The bolt is different. The extractor's different. I can't get those parts. I can't buy an extractor right now. So if I have an extractor kind of break on me in a class that I'm 2,000 rounds into and I've paid a lot of money to go to because you got to travel, what am I going to do? So that's kind of where this idea came in, to do a second version of it, like something I could take to class but is still set up the same way, which is where this Remington Defense comes in. So let me move this guy around. I have this factory... Turn this around here, and then I'm going to pick this camera up like this. So I have this Knights Armament rifle, which is a good rifle. I've had no problems with it. Super soft shooting. But I have this Remington Defense here that is actually also pretty rare also, but I've pretty much set it up exactly the same. So this thing came with the Midwest rail, the one you saw on the floor there, and I swapped it out for this AAC branded URX 3.1, which is ironic because... You know, Remington and AAC used to be the same company, so I'm kind of like bringing it back home. But they both have a mil-spec trigger, although granted, this Remington Defense has a worse trigger. It does have a little bit of sponge. I don't know if I'm going to swap it out or not, but I've pretty much set it up with the same stock. It has the same feel. This one has a carbine link gas system that ends right here, while the Knights Armament has its own custom kind of more than mid-length. You know, mid-length would then right here, but this one has a little bit longer. Very soft shooting. This Remington Defense rifle has a Cold Hammer forged chrome-lined barrel, just like the Knights Armament, but this is actually an M4A1 profile. It's very thick. It's a lot thicker than the M4 profile, whereas the Knights Armament is a little bit lighter. This thing comes factory with the Troy sights. It's actually all factory, except for the rail swap. It had that Midwest Gen 2 on it. So I've pretty much set this up. Functions the same way, has the same feel to it. I'm going to make some changes to it also, but this is so that I can pretty much have the same strength and feel and aesthetics, because it looks super cool. I love this kind of square profile, as opposed to the ones that have this big goofy barrel nut and then they taper. Like with the Geissele, I prefer the Geissele Mark IV over like the Mark 16 or something that like tapers thinner after the barrel nut. I think it gives it a very nice look to the rifle beyond looks. But when you talk about strength, one of the things that happened to me over the course of this pandemic is I ran out of 5.56. I didn't have any to shoot, but I wanted to keep training, which is where the third URX3 comes into play. It was actually my second one. So let me put that on the table and we'll talk about it. So I've taken my Knights Armament gun off the table. So I just have the Remington and the BCM here. But this is to my point. When I had only the Knights gun, I wanted something that I can train with even if I didn't have any 5.56. So this is a BCM. It's actually a BCM lower, a BCM upper. And it has a... not a DPMS, a Bushmaster 1-9 twist barrel. And if you'll notice, there's no gas tube. There's no gas block on this 1-9 twist. That's because it's set up with a CMMG 22 kit. So this guy is a dedicated only 22 long rifle. And I have my 9007 Steiner D-Ball. This guy is set up to run with night vision, which this one will eventually be once I get a second Steiner D-Ball. The idea being, if I need to go do some training at night, I have a 22 long rifle surrogate of my actual fighting rifle. So once this gets the Steiner D-Ball, they will technically match. And actually, this guy has already paid for itself. I actually had a small, tiny little class about how to do bounding drills, but I didn't have any 5.56. So I could take this out, and even though there's no recoil, I could actually do the bounding training drills with night vision with the same kind of simulacrum setup, even though I didn't have any 5.56 ammo. So during the pandemic, this rifle has paid for itself because it has like the same weight and the same feel and the same ergonomics. It just doesn't have the recoil. I can just take off the flash suppressor and put a can on it, even though it's really not any quieter. So this is kind of why I ended up with three URX setups. Eventually I will get a D-Ball to match, just to have an actual 5.56 night vision setup gun here. So that's kind of my rundown of why I like the URX3. It actually has the provisions built into it. It's super strong because it's not really relying on the barrel nut to align anything or hold zero. You don't have to rely on M-Lock, you know, dropping or getting loose or getting kinked or broke or whatever, or key mod or anything, because it actually has the rails built into it and it looks cool. So we're going to take a look at the URX4 just to see how it compares. So here's my Spikes tactical rifle. It's got a Spikes upper, Spikes lower, Spikes bolt. It is a pistol because it's an 11.5-inch barrel. This is the URX4. This is an older one. I got this pretty cheap. I probably paid $100 for it maybe 3 or 4 years ago. I have the special wrench to install it. If you'll notice, it has that unsightly gap. Don't like it, but it is real. And what I've done is I've recessed this silencer back into this rail because I really wanted like that PDW look. I think it looks pretty cool. It's still really loud. But you know, when you think about something like M-Lock or key mod mounts, I just don't think they're sturdy enough to really hold like a night vision laser the way I want. But I really want to mount it on the side for very specific reasons that are personal to me. I'm not necessarily going to mount a laser on the top. But I did install this also. You're supposed to torque it like to like a million foot-pounds to get it to clock around. And it takes shims. And the barrel nut is actually part of the rail. The rail is actually holding the barrel in, as opposed to being sandwiched between. And this is actually a two-piece rail. There are a couple mounting videos about it. But it feels good. It's nice in the hands, and pretty much that's all you can get these days unless you buy a rail to install it. When you buy an SR-15, it comes with the URX4 in M-Lock. They've kind of stopped carrying the key mods. One of the reasons I got this cheap is because, if you don't know, Knights only sells the things that they don't like to civilians. They actually sell all their best stuff to their LE and military customers. The civilians get kind of the crap, which is why there are like fit and finish issues on everything that comes out to civilians. But as you can see, it was actually set up for their proprietary length gas system, and then I have actually a mid-length gas system on this 11.5. So, and this is a Superlative Arms adjustable gas block. But as you can see, that mid-length gas system is a little bit shorter than what would be their proprietary gas system. Let me swap out the rifles again. We'll take a look at that. So the rifle on top is my Knights. The rifle on the bottom is my Spikes. And I've kind of lined up where the receivers match. You'll notice that unsightly gap there. Once you see it, you can't unsee it. And some factory Knights guns even have that gap. But if you look at the gas block on this Knights SR-15, it's a little bit longer. This one ends here. This one ends here. It's maybe an inch, 3/4 inch in difference. But if you'll notice, this 11.5-inch barrel with this Huntertown Arms cheap can is 16 inches or 17 inches overall length. So the barrel length actually matches, which really makes it cool. And I thought about putting like a PDW stock on here, but it's fine. It's fine the way it is. You know, I'm just going to shoot it. I haven't shot this one in a long time. I pulled the optic off and installed it on my Mark 18 clone. But at any rate, that's a real quick rundown of my feelings. I really think the URX3 is probably the perfect rail. And they're really hard to get these days. If I was going to choose a second place, it would be the Geissele Mark IV. And then if I was going to choose a third place, I don't even think ADM makes it anymore. But ADM pretty much copied this rail. Their ADM light rail, or the heavy rail, it has the same profile as this, except it has like that pinch barrel nut system. But I really think this is probably one of the best ways to get the most solid lockup, unless you go back to one of their old school free float rails like the Mark 12, which I have a Mark 12 and a Mark 11 rail. So I pretty much have every rail they've ever made except for the M4 RAS. And I got about 17 Knights Armament barrel nut wrenches to go with them. Anyways, I appreciate you guys watching, and let me know what you think.